Hi guys.
Hello.
Hey,
welcome to Baking Day.
Yeah, this is our first really official baking day where we're getting started. So this is gonna be fun.
I know, really fun. So today, Jen and I are just discussing, so let's just have a little chitty chat of what our week's gonna look like.
Exactly, of how our baking day can really help serve our families and us throughout the whole week.
Exactly. So we thought that for the very first week, we should start with the basics, which is our family bread. I mentioned this in the live yesterday. This is a bread that I think mom found in a cookbook.
Old cupboard or something.
Yeah.
When she was in an old home. I don't remember.
She loved to estate sale.
That's what it was.
So she found this old, beautiful baking recipe book, basically. And there was a bread recipe in there. And mom's been using it since the 70s.
Yeah, it's tried and true.
Tried and true. And so when I started making bread, probably a few years ago, once I had my girls, I think you were like, obviously do mom's bread. What are you, crazy?
Yeah.
But then I think I had a question and you didn't text me back fast enough. And then I called mom and she was shopping. And so I was like, oh, screw it. I'm just going to Google a recipe. And I found a really great recipe on a website that I love, so I'm not gonna hate on it. But I will say that it was fussy. Mm-hmm. It gave me ratios like, depending on the weather, use between this many ounces to this many ounces.
Right, and we don't want fussy.
And I was new, so I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing, I was always really insecure about the dough and the way it looked. It didn't feel right, didn't look right, but I didn't know because this was my first time making bread.
Yeah.
Well, I'll say this. Last week, I pulled up the recipe. I made mom's bread. It was easy, simple, came out fluffy and beautiful. Tried and true.
Girls who already follow me are making it like fiends.
Yes.
It is definitely tried and true.
Yeah. And then you can make a million other different variations.
That's the beauty of this bread. It's so universal. It's so versatile.
So we're going to start with our very first loaf of white bread. We're going to stock up for the week.
Right.
So for sandwiches, school lunches.
French toast,
whatever you want to make it for. And then today, we're gonna make ourselves a little BLTA sando.
We are. It's gonna be gourmet. It's elevated, like everything.
Are we making our own mayonnaise?
Yes, we are.
Next level.
Extra.
If you don't want to be that extra,
you don't have to be. Hellman's works.
I like Hellman's. Hellman's is the best.
Yeah, you don't ever want to go to Miracle Whip.
In California, I lived in California for a while, and it's not called Hellman's. It's called something else.
Mm.
I know. The first time I was in the store, I was like, it looks exactly the same. It has the same. But it's a different name, and I forget what it's called. But Hellman's to me is
there's also a lot of really good organic brands out there that are really, really good.
Yeah.
Even that Primal brand.
Give me my credit.
Hellman's any day. I know. If I'm making
a chicken salad, I mean,
I want your Hellman's.
I want my Hellman's, but let's make our own because I've never made my own mayo before. So let's make that.
Yeah, it's going to be delicious.
We're going to give it a little bit of a kick, right? We're
going to chipotle.
Yeah. So we're going to put some chipotle in there. Mm-hmm. And then, so what are we going to do? I need to, for Lucy's lunches, okay, I want to give her a healthy, fun little treat along with her snacks, okay? Or her lunch.
Yes.
So you had this great idea. You've been milling your own grain.
Yes.
Okay. So why don't you tell us about the cookie that you want us to make today?
Well, we really want to bring to you the option of you grinding your own, you know, flour because of its nutrients. It has the germ and the wheat germ and the bran intact. So it's very nutrient dense. So we really, as much as we can, we want to bring it to you as an option if you want to do it yourself. And like I've said before, you don't have to, obviously, but there are different styles you can get so it won't break the bank. I happen to have one that's, you know, electric. And so it's more on the pricier end. Because I grew up with a crank, like we talked about.
Jenny, you grew up cranking.
Grinding my own flour.
Wasn't it on the KitchenAid? I thought it was connected to the KitchenAid.
Well, if it was on the KitchenAid, girl, I would not be struggling
so
hard.
It was attached to the counter.
Wow. It would, like, yeah, attached to the counter, and then I would grind it. But you can still get a grinding mill. But here's the deal, why a grinding mill can work is because you only want to grind as much as you're going to be using in that recipe because it will go rancid unless you freeze it. So I just keep my berries berries that keep indefinitely, and then pull out just a scoop or two and grind that sucker up and use it right away. So it's absolutely beautiful. I recommend it. It's gonna be amazing. So we're going to be grinding our own flour today using soft white wheat, and which is good for pastries, and we're going and cookies and all of that. And we're gonna make a whole grain chocolate chunk cookie that, talk about extra. We're delicious. Using very fine ingredients, you know, grass-fed butter, pastured eggs, the whole works. You're gonna feel good about, with whole grain, you're gonna feel good about giving. And my kids and even my grandson fight over them. Yeah. So you know it's good, seriously.
Yeah. It's actually really good. I don't know if I could tell the difference between that cookie and just a regular sort of cookie with, you know, white flour and...
Right, it's that good. I will say I have another recipe that we will link you to that I, you know, made with just whole wheat flour.
Yeah.
That will also be a great substitute if you don't have a whole grain mill right now, so that you can at least use some whole wheat. Again, what's gonna be the difference? Because we even tasted both of them. They kind of taste similar. Right?
Different, a little bit of a different texture, but they taste very similar.
Right. I have to say, like, the whole grain one is like, is it heartier?
It feels a little heartier. Mm-hmm. Like, you're getting, like, this cookie is legit.
Right.
But when you have a cookie that is legit and it's filled with the best ingredients, mm-hmm. you can walk away from it. I've shared this in the previous
yes.
video.
Yes.
When I get myself around a mint Oreo double stuffed cookie,
you can't stop.
I can eat at least half of the family size.
Exactly.
When I tried Jenny's cookie, I was like, my God, this is delicious. I could have one with a cup of coffee.
And you feel good and you're done.
And I felt like I was done. And I've noticed that with my own girls. If I make them a treat filled with processed flours, processed sugars, whatever. Because again, I'm not a junk hater. Sometimes, you know, make the delicious, crazy
exactly.
treat.
It's a treat. Yeah.
They'll want it over and over and over and over. I mean, they want five of them. And then in an hour, they'll ask for another five.
Right.
But when I make them something that's really wholesome, made with the best ingredients, yeah. making sure that they're getting as much nutritional punch for the treat as they yep. can, they have one.
And they're done.
And they're done.
And the reason being, we were talking about this too, and I think it was in our live, is that when you feed your body nutrient dense foods, your body quits craving.
Yeah.
So you know, because that was the whole cycle of death.
Nobody binges on apples.
Exactly.
That's your first
exactly.
clue.
Exactly. That's your
Nobody's
first clue.
Nobody's like, God, get these bananas out of my house.
I can't keep them in the house anymore.
Yeah.
We're done.
Exactly.
We're done. Or broccoli, or peas, or salad.
When exactly. At the end of Thanksgiving dinner, you're not like, you know what? I could eat a pork chop. We don't
right.
say that.
No.
We're like, but I could have pumpkin pie.
Right.
There's something about that kind of stuff that we seem to be able to make room for, and that's because it's not nutritionally dense enough for satiating. So
right.
our goal here is to, we love to bake.
Or let's say this, if you feed yourself nutritionally, you could even say no to the pie and be happy with eating it later. It's like you really, your main default is that you feel so satisfied that you lose, like, well, I have to eat that. You know what I mean? All together, you kind of
I'm not there
that
yet.
Way.
I actually, to be honest with you, I eat dessert first on Thanksgiving.
Well, mom's always pushed for that. It's a perfect thing to do.
Because
you get it out of the way.
And plus, we want to show off what we've baked.
Right.
And so I don't want mom trying
I think
my
us
apple
women
pie.
Do it. It's
yes,
like, let's
the
cut
women
the
do.
Coconut cake. Let's cut the...
And then let's taste it. That's what we do. We cut into all of the
because
desserts
Because you don't
want
to be full when you eat that.
No.
You want your taste buds, like, primed. Your stomach empty.
That's when it's the best.
That's the full flavor moment.
That's when I can pass on dessert after dinner.
Exactly.
Okay.
Totally true.
Well, I'm really excited today to get these cookies, to make them for my girls, to see how they feel about mm-hmm. it. I don't have a mill yet. That's goals. So I'll be using at home. I'll be using whole grain, but I'll be really excited to see how Jenny uses hers. And then I'll make a plan for this month to get one of my own.
Right. Now, some of the things and the tools that you will want to maybe try out and what we're using is our menu planner. So if you're not familiar with my store, we do custom journals and planners. And this is our menu planner that I created, which really has always helped me in my planning for my family. But you can pick any art for your cover. I'm an artist, so you can pick any cover. But on the inside is where the gold is. And so you've got your, let me get to the right So here, like for your month of February, you have your calendar. So you can plan out your meals for the whole month, for 1 week at a time, however you want to do it, but you're organized. Then what you have here, which is your 1 month of meals. And how I like to categorize it is like, use it for dropping ideas and then pull the ideas and put them into your calendar. Then I'll even do lunch ideas and breakfast ideas. And then you can pull from them to put into your month of meals. Here's another gold, which is where it pertains to us a lot, is our baking day goals. So you've got week one, week two, week three, week four of what you want to bake for your family that will cooperate and coincide with your meals.
Yep.
So it keeps you organized. So look up for that. We'll drop a link below so that you can grab one of these too to stay super organized in the kitchen. So what are some of the... Also, so when we bake our cookies, we're going to show you an optimal way to freeze them.
Yeah.
So that kids aren't rummaging through them all week. And even though they are tasty, even though they will use discretion or not binge. But we want to show you the optimal way to freeze so that there's integrity in what you've done.
Integrity. Listen, 2020 was, let's get our health right, especially for me and my husband. It's almost like a respect issue. If I put 100 cookies in a jar,
yeah,
the poor man's like, give me a break. I'm trying. You know what I mean?
Right.
So a little bit out of a time, you know, just pull out one or two as a treat,
yeah,
four or five, pull out one for a special little lunch. Because I do find that if I load us up and I have a huge baking and I just leave it out to be eaten, mm-hmm, then it's too much grazing.
And I'll show you how to do it so that you can actually have them school lunch ready for your kids.
Yeah, and I don't want people resenting my cookies. I don't want them eating it resentful, like...
Yeah, like...
I have no choice but to eat this,
because they're there.
Exactly. Right. I want it to be respected.
Exactly. And your bread, it freezes very well. So I always bake a loaf and freeze a loaf because our recipe makes two loaves. So a lot of times I do quadruple loaf, but we'll show you a one loafer. And of course, you can braid one, whatever. But this week, we are going to show you how we're going to use the bread loaf in versatile ways. In one way, it'll be used as our BLT. And then... throughout the week, we'll kind of show you how we use the sandwich loaf and then, of course, the cookies. So,
yeah, and you can use this bread for lots and lots of things. And we'll have another episode showing you all the various ways,
yes,
you can use this bread for,
yes,
pretty much
we
everything.
Thought this was a good kickoff.
This is a good little starting point. I'm so excited. Okay, yeah. Let's get baking.
Hey, girls, we're ready to get started baking the white bread.
Okay, so, buddy, we start off with the warm water, right?
We've got our mixer, and, you know, if... I always get a lot of questions, so this is where I always want to explain where we do get our things,
please,
from. Because a lot of times women just have some questions. I'm going to pull an emerald, because this is what emerald does. You know, emerald is my favorite. Emerald,
I know, you're like, bam!
Oh, I've imitated him for years, but he always does this. Okay, I'm going to do this just for a second, because it's a tribute to emerald.
Yeah, babe.
Yeah. Everybody says that. Okay, so this is my KitchenAid. Now, I have a pro. Do you have a pro?
I have a pro.
Pro is awesome for the breads. You don't need it, of course. Mom's been using a regular mixer with this bread for years, but I will tell you, this is
but
a workhorse.
But Mom bought hers when I was born in 81.
So it had the metal gears.
When it had metal gears,
right,
and it was made properly. What they make now, if you make a lot of bread in it, it'll probably break on you.
It probably will. It probably will. Remember this. When you go to knead, keep it on number two, because if you go further than that, you will bust it. Okay? So I've busted probably three or four.
You'll bust it, and you can over-knead your dough.
Yes. You want to keep it low and slow.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay? Use your dough hook, and we're going to start by adding 3 cups of lukewarm water. You never want to be too hot. I've never used a temperature gauge. It's just lukewarm, okay? It's not a fussy bread. And then we've got 2 packets of
active rising yeast.
And if you buy your yeast in bulk, like I do, it's 2 1/4 is in each packet, okay? So what's that?
2 1/4 2 1/4 teaspoons is in each packet of yeast.
Right, so
for 2 packets of yeast or
4 1/2 teaspoons
of yeast.
There you go.
I'm not good at math, so...
You know what we forgot? We need some sugar to activate it. So you can use 2.
You don't have sugar in the recipe.
Anyway.
I haven't been using sugar because she did not have it in the
recipe.
I like
a little bit of an activator. You can use a tablespoon.
You have honey in the recipe on your website.
Well,
honey, right?
Let's do it. Let's do honey. Grab it. So you can either use a tablespoon of sugar or a tablespoon of honey. The honey, of course, is gonna make some, impart some really great flavor.
Really yummy flavor. I would prefer honey for sure. Yeah,
delicious, so here we go. Now I like to give it a little zhuzh.
Is a zhuzh necessary or do you like the zhuzh?
No,
I just used a wooden spoon.
You can use a wooden spoon.
Stirred it, okay.
Well, that's setting. Our first, it kind of goes in two rounds, this bread.
Okay.
We've got the first round, which is 3/4 cup of dry milk.
Start with that. We got to wait about five minutes for this.
We do. But what we're going to be using is 3/4 cup dry milk.
Okay.
Now, if I have gone and started baking my bread for the week and I'm like, oh, I'm out of dry milk, you can definitely omit it. But the crumb won't be as amazing and the taste won't be as amazing. But for someone who, if you're new at this, you'd never know the difference, honestly.
Yeah.
It's someone who knows the difference of making it with or without that's like, ah, dang, that dry milk, that's what makes it. And then what you're gonna do is 2 tablespoons of oil and 3 cups of flour.
Right.
And then you're going to mix that at a high speed for 2 full minutes.
All right, so let's wait till the yeast is ready for us.
Right, and this usually takes about 5 minutes.
And you can tell when yeast is ready because it gets all bubbly and foamy at the top, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so now it has proofed, as you'll see in the image here, that's what it should look like. So be looking kind of for that kind of a bloom. So now we're gonna go ahead and add our 3/4 cup of dry milk and our 2 tablespoons of, now you can use a, you know, vegetable oil, but I've always used light olive oil.
Okay. Okay, and then we start with 3 cups, right?
3 cups.
Are these like Jada De Laurentiis brand or something? These
no, Amazon.
Oh, I see.
They beautiful. What can you not get off Amazon?
I know.
Okay, now this is when you're going to mix this at a pretty high speed. I'd say you want to get it incorporated first, so go slow.
What kind of texture are we looking for with these first 3 cups?
It's going to be a kind of like a pancake batter.
Kind of like a pancake batter.
Yeah, we'll show you an image of what this looks like.
That was about a minute,
was it?
Say, or two, right, well, 1 to 2 minutes?
I thought it was 2. Was it 1?
It's closer to 2, probably.
Okay, that's all you need.
Okay, so about 2 minutes of that, and it does look exactly like pancake. It
looks amazing. So now for the next round, we're going to do 4 teaspoons of salt. So we've got our 4 teaspoons in here, and then we're going to now, I always want to say, here's a tip for breads and doughs and working with them. It really depends on the humidity of your home on how much you're going to really end up using in your dough recipe. So we're in the wintertime right now with low humidity, so we might even be more on the higher end of flour right now rather than the lower end. So take it cup by cup when you reach the latter end of the recipe on how much it's calling for. Just make sure that, because what you're looking for is for a ball, and to wick away from the bowl and to form a ball.
Yeah, okay. And so on average, you're looking at 5 to 7 cups.
Yes.
Okay, so we're gonna add another 2 here, which mm-hmm. would make it 6.
Right.
Starting to come together as a ball, isn't it?
Yes, it is. This is looking pretty good. And this was about
6 cups.
6 cups.
Put a little flour down.
Right.
Not too much, because then you don't want to add too much mm-hmm. to your dough, right?
Right.
Okay, so kind of a fold. And what do
yes.
you think about my technique?
So, you know what? It's spot on. So we could go slow-mo with this, but what you're doing is just kind of turning, pushing with the heel of your hand and pushing it forward. And then, right.
It's already feeling soft. It's already starting to feel fluffier in my hands, as if it's actually growing. As I'm kneading it, I can feel it becoming extra soft, extra flowy, extra pillowy. Mm-hmm. Pillowy is what it's starting to feel like.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Okay, nice soft dough. So a lightly greased bowl for it to rise in.
Yes.
And it's gonna rise for an hour?
It's doubled, which is about an hour.
Just put a little olive oil or butter in your pan and cover with a towel, yeah?
Yes, so until doubled, which is about
an hour. So check on it in an hour.
Yes.
So while that rises for us, doubles, which will be in about an hour, we're gonna get our cookies going. So Jenny's washing out the mixer and we're gonna start to make holy chocolate chip cookies.
Whole grain.
Okay, so we are ready to go. We are making our delicious whole grain chocolate chunk cookies using the finest ingredients.
Yes, and then we're using our modern recipe book, my iPhone. This recipe looks like it's from Grain Mill Wagon. It's a super cute website.
Right, and I've been using this one that I've been using, and it is... it's a winner, so we're just going to...
let's just follow this along.
Not change a thing. So here's my Nutramil, okay? So this is a Nutramil. You can get it at Nutramil.com. I think you can get it on Amazon, but I do believe it's a little bit pricier. So again, there's different ranges. I wanted mine to be pretty, blah, blah, blah. And so, of course, it's up to you on what you want to do.
Where do you get your grain?
My grain, I got on Amazon as well, and this is from a family-owned company, Organic Wheat Berries, and so I'm actually gonna show you these wheat berries.
Oh yeah, that's fun.
Okay, so I actually get them in this, and this is, I'm gonna get a little shout out because I have a friend of mine, this is their family, but it's...
oh really?
Yep, Palouse brand, I do believe, I hope I'm not butchering that, but that's really cool. It comes in this, again, this lasts indefinitely. If you don't have storage, I have a larger pantry, so it works for me. If you don't, you can get smaller, you don't have to, you know.
Yeah.
Get a 25-pound bag or whatever this is.
Don't deflate at looking at this. Like,
right.
What?
I know. This is soft wheat. You can also get little teeny bags. I got Kamut in a small little bag.
Okay.
This is a soft white wheat berry, and that's what you're looking for when it comes to cookies and pastries.
Okay.
So more of a hard...
and the benefit of this is that we get more of the nutrition.
We get more of the nutrition because when they put it on the store shelves, they have to, even in the whole wheat, they have, well... you know, in all purpose, they're extracting the wheat germ and the bran, which is what is the cause for its turns rancid with it. It doesn't have any shelf life.
They did it so it had shelf life.
So it had shelf life. And so even for the whole wheat, from what I've read, they had to take out a lot of it still.
Yeah.
So that it could be have a shelf life.
Right.
All right. And also I turned my knob over to make it really fine, which is what we're looking for with pastry.
How much do I put in?
I just do a little scoop at a time until we're gonna need 3 cups of flour.
Okay.
Okay guys, we have our freshly milled flour, which is just already, we're stoked because it's so,
I know,
roots.
Like, it's like we're going back to our human basics.
Exactly.
Homesteading.
Okay, now remember, we're all into like extra. We're into elevating the ordinary.
We're going to demonstrate the ideal for health, for fair trade, for all sorts of reasons.
Right.
Good, healthy chickens that aren't stressed.
Right.
Knowing that it's okay to use the other cheaper ingredients.
I mean, are we right or are we right or are we right?
Yeah.
But I mean, let's reach for the stars. Let's reach for the stars and land in the on the moon. No, wait. Reach for the moon and land somewhere in the stars.
Or a roof.
Now what we're going to do is we're going to do our wet ingredients. We're going to get our butter in here. So let me just show you what we're using. And this is...
I love V-Tel. I love V-Tel Farms.
V-Tel? Is it Vital?
Vital.
Christmas story, fragile.
So anyway, Vital Farms, they are pasture raised butter. I'm telling you, you will see the difference in the butters. They're a rich, darker color. Okay, now we're doing 2/3 cup brown sugar. So we used an organic brown sugar. And then we also have, we're gonna be using another organic, this is a less processed Full Circle brand cane sugar. So it's actually kind of looks like brown crystals.
Yeah, we're just going as, we want men to mess with it the least.
Exactly.
Is what we're going for.
The least processed we can do.
So 2/3 of the white, 2/3 of the brown.
And then we beat this up. Okay, so I really like to get it really light and fluffy looking. So now we're gonna add our eggs.
2 vitals.
I'm telling you, Vital. I'm telling you, these eggs are phenomenal.
An egg from a hen who has been treated well and eats grass and bugs and what they're supposed to eat, the ones on the prairie, their yolk will be orange.
Yes.
If you
get a dark orange.
If you get a yolk that is a light yellow or a yellow, then you know you probably got one that's eating lots and lots of grain and doesn't see a lot of grass.
Right.
Okay.
Or sun.
Yeah, exactly.
So what I like to do is I like to really whip my cookie, this section of it, with the sugars, butter, and eggs. And I've done it without whipping it and with whipping it, and the cookie's texture comes out better with whipping it.
Perfect. Put both in for you.
Okay. Okay, so we have whipped it. We're gonna go ahead and show you what that looks like, okay? So when it gets whipped pretty good, now we're going to add some vanilla. Let's add our vanilla because it's also wet. I kind of like doing it.
This is Jenny's homemade vanilla.
We're gonna do a different baking show for this. We're gonna show you how to make your own vanilla. It's really easy.
Okay, so we need 2 teaspoons. Do we want another medium bowl to whisk the other ingredients?
No, because I never do. Now, it does call to do that. I'd have to say I've never done that in my life.
Because it's just an extra step and an extra bowl.
I always do the wet first, and then I put all my dry in.
Yeah, okay.
And then I mix it. This is baking soda and baking powder and our salt.
Yep, so that is 1.5 teaspoon baking powder, 1 teaspoon baking soda, 1.5 teaspoon kosher salt. Dump that right in there.
Mm-hmm. Now, are we going right into
We're going right in. 3 cups freshly milled.
Oh yeah, baby.
Flour.
Now, while I'm putting this in, because I actually like to put my chocolate chunks in with the flour mixture. Just the less beating on the chocolate, the better.
Should I start chopping this up?
Yeah, so what we're using, she's using some Ghirardelli, or is it Guittard?
It's Ghirardelli.
Ghirardelli, 60% cacao.
60% cacao, bittersweet chocolate.
Now, of course, you can use whatever you want. I use
semi-sweet. Mm-hmm. This is just what was available.
Mm-hmm. Get some good quality
chocolate. Yes.
Of course, you could use chocolate chips. What was the fun in that?
I mean, it's still fun, but it's like, this is next level.
It's next level.
We're reaching for the stars, right?
Yes.
Okay, I need a knife.
No, we're reaching for the moon, buddy.
Oh, yeah.
The moon.
I'm reaching for the roof.
It's harder than what you think it's going to be, isn't it?
A sweat.
You know how it works. I want to take the knife and do it for you.
I know you do.
I'm so bold.
I remember one time Jenny was helping me paint a picture. I was like, painting. I was like, hey, I really,
that's so funny.
I was like, I really want this particular effect on the flower. And you're like, okay, so go ahead and use the white. And then, okay, you know what? Move.
Is that too big? I say the bigger is better because when it melts, like splats, and it's like this.
Perfect.
Get these in the oven. Now, you can also choose to use a nut of your choice. I used, when I make it, I'll do like a slivered raw almond or pecans, and I will chop them up. So, but if you want to know what, maybe your kids don't like that, my kids happen to, which is odd actually, then add it in. Or omit, whatever you want to do.
Perfect. It smells like freshly milled flour.
It does.
Look at that.
Very nutty. It smells nutty.
It does. It's that bran and
like a
germ.
Nutty and sweet combo.
Yeah. You could even taste this dough, honestly.
Yeah, we're gonna have to do the dough test.
Seriously.
Mmm. Sometimes I wonder why I even make a cookie when the dough's so good.
So let's get these onto a cookie sheet.
Okay. Okay, so show me how to scoop with two.
Okay, now you can use cookie scoop, and I will have to say, I have bought so many, and they're worth just rebuying, but they break all the time. Those teeny little scoops.
Yeah.
So I have a monster scoop, but I don't really want to do that, and especially when it comes to freezing these cookies. We want to keep them nice and snack size, not monster, and then kids eat half of it and waste it, and then you have to eat it. You don't want that.
Exactly.
So anyway, you can use two scoops. My mom always taught me, you know, my mom always, she's very much so Martha Stewart, I would have to say.
That's really?
A good way. Mom? Yes.
Martha
everything,
Stewart in what way?
Everything is precise in a way that it's clean, precise. So when you go to measure out your flour, you scoop it out, you take a knife, you chop it up top, and then you dust the side.
Mom is an ambiance master.
She really is.
Her ambiance and the process is more important to her than the end result.
That's amen to that. I like to say that I've taken from that. I don't do that, but all the time. But man, but what's great about mom is that she taught you how to do it right.
Yeah.
That way, if you wanted to fall away from it a little bit, you always know where to go.
Exactly.
For how to do it right.
She taught us how to clean right.
Yeah, that was kind of a pain, but we know how to clean the home.
But now you know what a clean, actual,
you know
real
what a
clean
she's
house
like,
is.
What's this? You never even touched this. This is, you have to clean baseboards. I'm like,
why? Baseboards, the spindle on the railing.
Ugh. A mom, again, she enjoys cleaning.
She does. She
makes One time I was pregnant, I was dry heaving all the time, so I had her come clean my boys' powder room, bathroom, and she literally came over with a gas mask. She's like, I'm going in. Okay. So she always kind of did this, where it would kind of like, you know, she's getting it into a nice form. You're not using your fingers, you know, there you go.
I have never seen mom do that.
Growing up, that's all she ever did. That's
see,
how she taught me to do it.
Because I'm the baby by like 10 years, I got mom who doesn't give a crap that much. Like, she was like,
lesson up in her ways as she got older.
She's like, where are you going? I was like, friend's house. She's like, you coming home or?
Right.
Where Jenny, you would be over like 9:30.
Oh, man.
Dusk.
Oh, man. You did it now with the phones. You could track your kids. My mom tracked me without a phone. I don't even know how she did it, but she knew.
I got the same
You know
mom,
what it was? The Holy Spirit always
told
her.
The Holy Spirit. Like,
She's like, something's wrong with Jenny. Something's wrong with Jenny.
Also, too, though, you were really cute as a teenager. Okay. I think I was so chunky, barely wore makeup, big frizzy hair, didn't do anything with it. She was like, she'll be fine. we're not gonna find her in the back of some sports car with a boyfriend. Not you either, but I'm just saying. She wasn't worried. And it's true, I was eating a frozen pizza with my girlfriends watching Clueless. So she had nothing to worry about.
Oh, gosh. Okay, now look at this. This is perfect. This is going to render some perfectly good medium-sized cookies.
So you're not even flattening it. You're just letting it spread.
You don't need to. They flatten out perfectly on their own, and I know sometimes you got to do that with cookies. Not this one.
Perfect.
So in we go. Okay, so here we are. We've got our bread that's been rising for about an hour, and you'll see how much it has risen. It's phenomenal.
Heaven on earth.
So you're going to want to punch this down, and usually I do more of a knead over, a fold over, I should say.
I just gave mine a punch and walked away, but that's good.
It's good to kind of get it
good
back into its bowl. There we go. Another just about 30 minutes.
Keep an eye on it. Mine rose super fast because I was baking a lot and my kitchen got warm.
Warm, and that'll do it every time.
So check it, make sure it's not over.
Right, don't want to do that. Don't ever let your bread rise and go run errands. But in the meantime, while that's going, we're gonna get everything. Let's get this BLT sandwich ready.
Oh, I'm ready.
Okay, so for our mayo, we're going to be using an egg yolk. This is from our Vital Farms. And we've got a cup of oil, a mild tasting, so we're using a light olive oil.
So we're gonna do about a tablespoon of lemon. You put it over your hand, you can catch the seeds, so that's always nice.
If you have a paper cut,
don't do it.
Don't recommend. The worst day of your life.
Don't recommend.
Sometimes you don't even know you have a little paper cut.
No, that's the worst.
If there's one thing she knows how to do is whisk. Look at this technique, ladies. Grab your notebooks,
Take
notes.
Yep.
Okay.
You might need a close-up.
I'm gonna slowly add that in. Slowly add in your cup of oil.
Slowing up if it's not getting incorporated well. Oh, this is looking really, really good. And we're talking a very slow, steady stream. You'll see a good picture, but this is good. This looks like mayo. Way more yellow than regular mayo.
That's true.
I'll tell you what. She's getting a workout today.
Oh my God, this is really.
Want a trace?
Serious.
You want a trace?
No, because the ladies at home, they may not have a partner in the kitchen.
Yeah, you're right.
They need to be inspired and never give up.
You're so right.
Don't quit.
You're so
Don't
right.
quit. This almost looks like a little lemon custard.
It is. That is what it looks like. Yum.
Fight the pain.
Fight the pain. We've almost got it.
Go into your pain cave. That's what marathon, ultra marathon runners.
Go into your pain cave.
They call it going into the pain cave.
Oh, this looks gorgeous.
Okay. Now we're gonna add a little chipotle and get real sassy with
ours.
Yes,
we are. So now we're gonna add a pinch of salt.
Timer on that. Did you put a timer on that?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
So now this is what we have. This is Chipotle's diced chipotle peppers. And so we're gonna use, it's like an adobo sauce, which is like the sauce of the peppers. So we're adding that in to our taste.
Shall we do the pinky test? Mm. More salt.
Oh, needs a little bit more salt. I'm liking where that's going.
I'm liking, does it need a little bit more adobo?
It does. So now we're dealing with a teaspoon. Oh, that's gonna be, I can't even.
Yeah, this is yum.
Oh, I mean. Salt. You know what would be good in that is probably garlic, but salt is good. We're gonna keep it simple.
Oh, do you have garlic, quick?
I do. Do we wanna do the powder or do we wanna do?
Put some garlic, let's do powder.
Ooh.
Oh,
that's really good. I would have to say that could probably stand a little bit of chipotle, but that's just me. What do you think?
A little bit more.
Half a little
teaspoon
bit more.
Mm-hmm. You got to be careful with chipotle because then when you go overboard, then you're in pain. But that is so subtle.
It's actually, chipotle isn't too spicy.
I don't want it to take over the sandwich.
No, you don't.
Mm. Ooh. Now I taste it.
Oh, that's a winner.
That's good. Okay, we got a lot going on, so let's check out our cookies before those get burned.
Okay. 8 minutes, you know. I don't know if I ever told you that. Oh, yeah. Okay, so let's go ahead, though, and get our bread in the oven so that we can make our sandwich. So what I want to do... Good.
Okay.
Very good. So we're going to
spray this out and cut it in half.
Yes. Spray it good.
You just eyeball and
I
slice,
do.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Get it in a good even, two even pieces of dough. And then let me show you the technique that I'm sure you do too, Anna, to get it formed easily.
And well, let me see what you do, because I'm curious if I'm doing it right. I mean, it works for me, but maybe I'm not.
Okay, so what I've always done
just
is,
go like this.
Yeah. To get, I like mine super smooth, so I'll kind of flatten it out, and then I roll it like this, seam side down, cup it over, and that way it's ultra smooth.
Uh-oh, it's not very smooth.
Bam, which is what you want.
That'll work.
That'll work.
It'll grow.
Yes, it will.
So, getting over, you want to make sure you tuck in the ends of the sides too, because it will. Yep.
Okay.
Nice.
Okay, then we need that to go until it's about an inch, until it rises about an inch above.
Right, and so we're going to give it about a good 30 minutes.
Perfect.
Okay, so the bread is about to be, we've already let it rise a little bit, about 30 minutes. Got it in the oven, 40 minutes at 375. It's tried and true, 40 minutes, 375. It's just never been anything
but. I put it in once it rises about an inch above the pan. So
right.
When it rises about,
that, 30 minutes.
About 30 minutes, yep.
Okay, I'm gonna try this.
Let's split it,
because yeah. We've already been trying a lot. I ate a lot of dough,
to be honest. Yeah, we need room for the BLT. Right. Oh, look at that. Let's get a close-up.
Ooey gooey.
Oh! That's where the chocolate chunks, like, surpass, dink, the chocolate, you know.
Okay. It's a little bit nuttier, but in a
the dark chocolate is very prominent. If your kids don't like dark chocolate, or even yourself, because I'm prone to like more of a semi-sweet. But I know my husband loves dark chocolate.
I don't think this is too dark. I mean, these are for my girls, and I don't think it's too dark.
For my family, I think it is.
Oh.
But I'm just saying, that's what different tastes can do. But this is a delicious, decadent, gourmet cookie. I mean, you'd find this in a bakery. Am I right?
It's a little bit salty. I love my cookies to be a little bit salty.
It is. But it's like, you know, it's kind of like, it was like one of those kind of cookies with like sea salt on top. That's almost like it's what's coming through.
I think the coarse salt helps, really comes through and does that.
That is delicious.
It's hearty, it's delicious, satisfying, yum.
Okay, over the top. Now let's get our bread out of the oven. We have some that have already, we had two cycles coming through, so these are definitely ready to come out.
Yum!
Okay.
A little brown on top.
It is.
Is that normal for you?
Mm-hmm. No, not necessarily.
But it's still delicious, obviously.
Oh yeah, it's delicious.
Okay. I'm starving. I'm ready for a BLT.
Me too. So let's go ahead and get started. We're going to cut into it and show you how to assemble and make the BLT. Okay, so we have the bread cut. It's absolutely gorgeous. And it's hearty and sturdy. It's not that kind of bread that is so light that it falls apart.
Yeah.
You don't want that
for
a sandwich bread. And there's been many a times that's I've seen and have made a loaf like that.
Mine was like that when I used another recipe that wasn't this one.
Right. This is the tried and true. It's true sandwich bread.
We're going to toast it. I'm so excited.
Okay, so we've got our toasted bread, homemade bread.
Lather it. Let me film some up close. Lather it with that mayo. Hold on, let me get a video going.
Probably on both sides.
Both sides. Oh, yeah, definitely. What are you, crazy?
Yeah, you need this flavor spread. Like Guy Fieri always says, and I know you're not a fan of him, but you know, you could put this on a boot and eat it and it'd be good.
Yeah, exactly. It's not that I'm not a fan of Guy Fieri, it's that I feel like he's oversaturated.
He definitely is. So we've got the mayo. Now we're gonna go to iceberg. You know why iceberg? Because it's crisp.
Not a lot of nutritional content.
No,
but crisp.
We're going for, you know?
Exactly.
That's right. What we're going for. Okay. Now, we like to season all the way through. So now, this is kind of a hard thing to keep season on, but we're going to attempt it anyways. I like to keep my pepper and salt nice and easy to grab. Now we're going to add our bacon to keep it stable. Probably three, because, you know, it's a hearty sandwich. Okay. Bacon, and then we've got tomato. Now we're definitely going to be seasoning these. Yeah. So we're going to do three. These are nice and thickly sliced. Delish.
So delish.
Buddy, should I? Bam! You know it. You know it. I had to. Okay, now the piece of resistance.
Avocado.
Let's do it. Okay. So.
Oh, This is going to be messy in all the best ways.
It's going to be one of those things that...
A little salt and pepper on that.
A little salt and pepper. And now...
Oh, yeah. Oh! What is this?
Buddy!
What is
showstopper.
This? What is this?
Okay, we're going to go ahead and cut this in half.
Oh my gosh.
Easy to...
Oh yeah.
How does it?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh, oh stop.
Oh.
Uh-oh. Put your bacon back in there.
Get back.
Oh,
No, stop.
Mm-mm.
Stop. This is going to tear up the roof of my mouth, and it's going to be worth every moment of it.
All right, let's go in.
Wait.
Mmm. Butter. Huh?
Butter.
Mm-mm. Mmm. Okay, let's...
First of all, it's seasoned perfectly.
Yes. I was just going to say that.
I'm so glad we did it all the way through. It's seasoned perfectly.
That chipotle?
Stop.
There's
the cookies. Our first batch got a little burnt because we missed that
bell.
We missed that bell. We were too busy talking or something. Okay. So I actually got the chipotle mayo first.
Me too. It really... And it's... Oh, it's just like, that's that chipotle mayo. Oh my gosh.
Okay.
The bread. No other bread would, if you don't use this bread, it'll probably ruin it.
Uh-huh.
I mean.
Okay.
Let's be honest.
Oh my gosh. I got avocado.
It's tomato. Creamy with the avocado.
Crunchy with the lettuce.
The lettuce. Creamy with the tomato. Why do I taste garlic? Oh, I taste it in the chipotle.
Yes. It's perfect.
No.
It's perfect.
In every sense of the word.
I feel like we need to open up a diner.
Well, that's obvious.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
Well, yes.
Okay. This, cookies.
Buddy,
this was the most successful baking day.
We got cookies for our families we milled our own flour. We've got homemade bread using a really good King Arthur brand bread flour that is least processed. They do not use any kind of chemicals and things in theirs, which we love. And of course, we have so many different versatile things we can do with our homemade bread, including this dynamite BLT, which don't even think that this guy can't be used for dinner. Not just lunch.
Oh my gosh, are you kidding? My husband
gourmet sandwiches for dinner are just, I mean, sliver up some potatoes and make your own chips.
Stop. Stop.
It's another show.
Stop while you're ahead.
It's another show.
Stop. Pump the brakes.
Pump the brakes.
I can't take it. It's too good.
Pump the brakes. I'll have to make homemade chips one time.
Buddy, this was awesome.
Happy, fun baking day. We hope you're baking with us. We'll see you next week. Bye.